Alright, so you guys all know why you're here. Woo! Let's everyone give Adam Kokesh a warm welcome to the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest number 3. Adam is out on his American Campfire Freedom Tour.
Awesome.
It is a book tour. He has books on the back table. He is giving out and is doing some autographs. And I do see there is a tip jar over there. So make sure to welcome Adam with a good tip for his signatures. And he is out to spread the word of freedom and to help us all do the same thing. And that is part of the reason for his books. So welcome, Adam.
Well, thank you all very much for being here. And as part of the American Campfire Tour, I have to apologize that that's a little bit of false advertising. Actually, we did have a campfire last night right over there. It's awesome, beautiful to see the community coming together here. But the reason it's really false advertising is that this is probably better described as the Adam Kokesh Avoids His Probation Officer Tour. And on that count, it's going very well. I haven't seen him since California. So, but now I have this wonderful piece of government jewelry attached, if you didn't notice. The sock is my effort to bedazzle it a little bit. Actually, it's to keep it from chafing. Has anybody ever had to wear one of these? No? Isn't it such an interesting, like, anachronism of government today that there are people, and for me, it's funny because I don't have any restrictions. I used to be banned in D.C. Last time I went to court, I got the ban lifted in negotiations with the judge. Representing myself for the first time in this case, actually, it was really satisfying. But being allowed back in D.C. is not worth having to wear an ankle bracelet. The other funny thing about this, and this was true when I was in California, is that despite being on probation and have to take random drug tests, when I was in California, I had to call every single night and find out if the next day I was going to have to take a test. But because weed is legal as it is medically in D.C. and legal in California, I was allowed to smoke pot. Your tax dollars at work, right? This is for smoking a joint in front of the White House, you know, joint summit with President Trump a couple of years ago. If I had been in the White House inside the building, like, I would have been okay, but out front, they still don't allow that stuff. But recently, I got to go back to D.C. I don't think that's a proper sentence.
It's Mordor.
Had to go back to D.C. there for court, and got to make a couple other fun videos. And one of the things that I was asked recently in an interview was, who's the coolest famous person you've ever met? And for those of you who don't know, I did a radio show for a while. It got canceled because I wouldn't sell any ads. And then it got picked up as a TV show. And for 4 months, I had a TV show on RT America, you know, the bottom rung of the legitimate television ladder. But still, right, you're on cable. And then I went independent with Adam versus the Man Online. And it's possible because so many people care about this message, make it possible for activists like myself to do what we do, and you know, we are really forever grateful of that. And to be able to connect with with communities like this is really cool, because most people who are famous in America, this is my answer to the question, they're famous for bullshit reasons. And instead, I get to hang out with people who are waking up, people who care about this message, amazing activists. Everywhere we go, there's someone else who, in a just world, would be more famous than anybody in Hollywood for the kind of work that you people are doing to make the world a better place, people who are engaged, who are waking up. So one of the fun things that we've got to do all over the country is ask different communities the same question. And it's really fun to see what answers come out first. So what I'd like to ask, and feel free to shout out answers, what do you see people doing in their daily lives differently? How do you see people living differently as a result of an awareness of the message of freedom?
Agorism. Unschooling.
Wait. Hold on. Before we go any further, because I mean, maybe I don't have to say this out here, but there's a little housekeeping that goes along with this question. If you're a cop, would you please raise your hand? Good. Well, we haven't caught anybody like that anyway. You will not be held accountable for anything you say here today, okay? So we had agorism, big, big topic, right? Sam Konkin. We had unschooling. A lot of things that go along with unschooling, right? In terms of raising free-range children. Wait, we're not supposed to say that. Because then we have to explain to the status that we don't actually want to eat them. Well, what else? What goes along with unschooling?
Peaceful parenting.
Peaceful parenting, absolutely. What else? A couple big ones with two other big ones with that.
Empathy.
Well, with raising kids in particular, by these values.
Nonviolent communication.
Absolutely. You know what? It's awesome to hear that. Normally, I have to ask later, and people are afraid. Are there any students, fans of nonviolent communication here? That's awesome. That's like the best show of hands we've had yet. A little over a third of the audience.
Michigan.
Michigan. All right.
We have a teacher of NBC here.
What else goes with raising free-range kids, though? There's two other big ones that we usually get.
Not vaccinating,
absolutely. When the government says, well, you got to put all of these needles in your kid, at least you're going to question that, right? One other big one. Now, this is a little more difficult, maybe.
Growing your own food.
Absolutely. Not about raising kids, but definitely relates to that. That's huge. Macy and I, who's traveling with me, you'll get to meet her later, we just got engaged a few weeks ago.
Oh. Undocumented marriages.
Hey, if you're ever giving a speech and you're like struggling for an applause line, it's really easy. All you gotta say, we just got engaged. I can't wait to tell people like, hey, we just got married, and then, oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. Okay, but we've been talking about having kids, and close enough to the specifics that we're watching videos about this. Anybody see where this is going? There's one on YouTube that I really like that involves a creek and a yoga mat, and a woman going, oh, I'm having a baby. Home birthing, anybody?
Yeah.
Creek birthing, right? Libertarian women are hardcore. Oh. Okay, so growing your own food, right? Moving on, there's a couple other big areas of lifestyle changes that people make, right? Growing your own food. Why would you grow your own food?
Independent.
Self-sustainable.
Great, two great answers there. Being independent, being self-sustainable, and then because you know what's in it, because you want that health. You don't trust the FDA, right? Well, the FDA said it's okay to eat, I'm just going to put it in my body without question. You kind of goes out the window, right? So what else, both of those open up huge other areas. So what else do you see related to that? Being self-sustainable or knowing what's in your food, what you put in your body.
Not eating according to the government's diet plan.
Yeah, the food pyramid, right? You get,
paleo.
Eating paleo, great. We've noticed that as a pretty clear trend in the movement, right?
Yes.
It's hard to get those people to shut up sometimes.
I love carbs.
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
But you don't have to go to the grocery store, so you don't have to spend any money on food.
Yes, it is way more economically efficient, just a smart economic choice, right? To be able to grow your own food at home. What else? Bueller. I got quiet fast.
Health?
There's some health ones?
Well, security.
Security, absolutely. Big one. Have you noticed that libertarians tend to open carry a little more than the general population? Yes.
Yeah.
Concealed carry. But even, I'm glad you put it that way, sir, because it's deeper than that, right? It's really about taking charge of your own security and not being dependent. When you realize that, hey, calling the cops is usually not in the best interest of your health or personal safety, right? That, you know, you're going to take charge of that one way or another, whether it's pepper spray or a taser or a firearm or just being more intelligent about your security situation in general. And more than any of those weapons of defense, even engaging with the world intelligently is far more important for maintaining a secure life, right? What did you say?
The Peacekeeper app.
Peacekeeper app, absolutely. Connect, using technology to connect for accountability along with recording cops, right? And you interact with authority differently, right? When you understand your rights, Am I free to go? Am I being detained? Very popular saying.
Yeah.
Okay, a couple other big ones we're still missing. What else?
Authentic relationships.
Absolutely. You know what? Normally we have to have Macy in the back whispering the answers for people to get that one. But yes, more authentic relationships goes very well hand in hand with nonviolent communication. But just when you relate to someone, you know, as a real person,
yeah.
Is someone deserving of self-ownership? Right? Like, you're able to connect with them better than if you treat them as an object, maybe, right? Or property, or just someone to control or manipulate. And I have to say, I've done a very good job on this count. Every woman that I've ever dated was a libertarian by the time she broke up with me. But now, I have Macy, my fiance, and because we both get this, we're both passionate about NBC and about freedom, you know, you're able to connect on a deeper level. And you see that in our movement, do you not? I mean,
yeah.
Aside from all the single INTJ males who just crawled out of their parents' basements after spamming for Ron Paul. What else? Fitness, health. Just a couple other ones.
Introspection.
Would you say meditation then? Self-awareness?
Yeah, that's a part of it.
Absolutely. And that we see as a trend. There's another big health one that goes along with that.
Emotional health.
Emotional health, absolutely, but with meditation specifically.
Yoga.
Awesome. Thank you. That's what I was going for. Now I'm a bit of a, you know, consistent practitioner myself with Macy. Even on the road, we've been doing it pretty consistently for about 10 months now, which is how long we've been living out of that trailer, by the way. Speaking of authentic relationships, living together 24 hours a day, working, we know every smell that our bodies can possibly produce. But yoga. Now, I know male-dominated movement, a lot of guys a little anxious about doing yoga, but you really owe it to yourself to try it two or three times. And I say that because there's a huge range of experiences you can have, from a very calm, meditative, restorative session to a 90-minute Bikram hot yoga session. It'll kick your ass harder than a military calisthenics workout. I'm not kidding. You can get up in the morning and run half an hour with the Marines and do an hour of push-ups and sit-ups and other bullshit, and then go have a regular day of blowing shit up and killing people. I can't do hot yoga in the morning. Bikram, at least a Bikram session, I'm done for the day. Like, you're just wasted. I drink a gallon of water and pass out afterward. But for the guys who are a little apprehensive about being judged, I got two words for you. All of that goes away. Yoga pants. They are so comfortable. For those of you that haven't done any serious yoga, you might not know, it was originally developed as a warm-up for meditation. And every good 90-minute session ends with 5 to 15 minutes of being calm and relaxed and just lying in meditation and enjoying that state of connectedness with your body. And there's something that really goes along with that. Now let me break before we get to the next big subject that you all missed. Well, there's two actually that we missed. But how many of you, just from your awareness of how people wake up, well, do you guys know what I mean by that? Like, it's a one-way street, right? Nobody goes, yeah, freedom, liberty, we're going to respect other people's rights, and we're going to establish a free and voluntary society, and it's going to be awesome, and peace, and love, and harmony, and then, wakes up the next morning, never mind, fuck it, let's just point guns at people I don't like, right? So just from that, we're going to come back to, where this is going, but do you guys have a sense, viscerally, that we are on the right side of history? Yeah?
Yeah.
Good. All right, so you see that along with that now, there's a deeper movement almost, right? A cultural movement, a self-realization movement. And all of these things play into it. But there are two big ones still that we're missing, that people are sometimes afraid to give us answers to this question. I'm a little surprised out here, as much as you guys came out with so many good answers already that we normally have to cheat people into. Two big ones.
Bitcoin.
What else? Bitcoin. All right, getting close. Why would you use Bitcoin?
It's not Federal Reserve notes.
Because it's not Federal Reserve notes. Why do you not want to use Federal Reserve notes?
Perpetuating the economic control of the state.
By? Inflation, which is a form of?
Taxation,
thank you. Did we really have to go through all that?
Not paying taxes.
Like when you realize that taxation is theft and the government uses a lot of the money that you give it to hurt other people, right? Now, Bitcoin is one example of that. Gold, silver, alternative currencies. Agorism in general, right? Like conducting your economic affairs outside of the purview of government. And for some people, this is civil disobedience, right? And by the way, there's a book now called Three Felonies a Day.
Yeah.
Because that's how many of the average American commits. And it's normally financial crimes. Like anytime you barter something over $20, you're supposed to report it on your taxes. But people were, thank you for the three sound effects of people like, at the same time. Well, it was like a chorus, like 1, 2, 3. It was really cool.
Even growing your own food is a way to not pay taxes.
Absolutely. All of the things that we do in self-sustainability that are not interacting with the system by which you have to have on-book transactions is you know, a form of evading taxes. So for some people, it's working under the table, right? You know, doing business as an LLC or as a nonprofit or whatever the case may be to minimize their liability, legally or quasi-legally, whatever. But most people are able to do this. And I think it's something we should talk about more. We should celebrate in our movement because a lot of people are making very beautiful life decisions where they're saying, I see the extrinsic value in living this way. I don't care if I have to take a pay cut. I'm going to live better and I'm going to be happier. Right?
Yeah.
Speaking of being happier...
Drugs.
Thank you! were people afraid to be like... Libertarians like to smoke pot. Are we still embarrassed about that? Is it like still some movement, self-consciousness of that? I would hope not, right? Well, I think when you reject status drugs, nicotine, caffeine, alcohol, right? Was it live, work hard, die young, forget that you're a slave? Hey, maybe alcohol is not the best drug of choice when you realize that there are safer, healthier alternatives. But we know why marijuana is really illegal, right? It's a gateway drug.
To Doritos.
It's a gateway to freedom. Because you can't smoke pot and not realize that the government is totally full of shit. Jeez. But, you know, I mean... For me, I went to the VA when I was having trouble sleeping in D.C., and they gave me 5 prescriptions, 3 of which had suicide lists as a side effect. One of them was Prozac, and I ran a peer support group at the time for vets with PTSD in D.C. called Homefront Battle Buddies. It was pretty clear that the guys who were able to smoke pot were at least able to control their symptoms and get the talk therapy that they needed to deal with what they were going through, as opposed to the guys that took the prescriptions and the alcohol and crawled into bottles and destroyed their lives, right? What's scary about this, though, is not even that, but, well, I'll come back with a little comparison in a second. Every time we turn around, it's like pot cures something else, right? And I remember back like a couple decades ago when California was debating medical marijuana, and it was like, oh yeah, dude, it's for my glaucoma, right? And they had to use that. And it's not just that glaucoma is an extremely painful thing, and like getting high deals with the pain, but it actually, there's a pressure on the cornea that you get with glaucoma that is not relieved by anything nearly as effectively as smoking pot. And it's crazy. And then you go, seizure kids. You've heard these stories now, right? That there are kids who are born into living hell who have seizures like all day long. And yet there are still legislators in America actively working to keep that medicine illegal. To send parents to jail for giving that to their kids. And if there is any kind of just hell, and I seriously doubt it, there is a special place for those people. But even from my experience with marijuana and PTSD and all the vets that I saw using it successfully, there's something else that when I realized it's just, I mean, every time you turn around, right, the only time you're wrong is when you say you've gotten to the bottom of the rabbit hole, because there is no bottom. And for me, it was, I read an article last year, this particular experience about PTSD, I read an article last year about Molly, MDMA, Anything. If they make weed this legal, by the way, how illegal is weed here? Wait. Oh, it's really great to know that you guys just legalized weed here. I'm really excited that we get to enjoy this. It's legal here, right?
It's legal. That's where I go.
You're just not allowed to carry more than you can put in your mouth at one time.
Yeah.
Isn't that how it works here? Okay, so it's legal. But what do they make really, really, really illegal? So, Molly, MDMA is one thing, right? You know, I mean, even here, if you get caught with weed, small, like what, less than half an ounce here? Something like that, right? It's
in some cities, but state laws.
Okay. But still, most places in America now, you get caught with a small amount, you're not going to jail. You might get booked, you might get processed, you might catch a misdemeanor charge. But there are other substances that if you have at all, right, you go to jail.
DMT.
DMT. What else? Yeah, for those of you that don't know, LSD, thank you. On my YouTube channel, I have my first 6 experiences smoking DMT ever. I don't really know how that happened. Someone came to me and was like, hey, I've got some DMT. You've got a camera and a YouTube channel. I said, well, you better find a place for this to happen before I think of one of a million reasons this is a terrible idea. Next thing you know, I'm that guy on YouTube, right? So, Molly, though, 2 hits, 2 therapy sessions supervised by a professional therapist, 2 weeks apart, cures PTSD in all clinical senses for over 90% of patients. Just like that. How much is Molly? Does anybody know? A hit of Molly? I know some of you know. From last night, I know some of you know. $30? How about on the Silk Road or whatever's replaced it now, I wouldn't know.
It doesn't exist.
It's on the darknet. It doesn't exist. Really, Mom. $20 maybe? Yeah. Right? $10, $20?
Oh, I said it's $10.
$10?
$10.
For all kinds. $10. Okay. The point is, if they allow this stuff to be made legally, it would cost more to package and deliver it than to manufacture it. You compare that to a lifetime of Prozac and therapy? Gee. It wasn't because in the 80s when they were developing this as a couples therapy drug, someone said, oh my gosh, they're having fun with this. We have to make it illegal now. No, that's what they want you to think. Oh, we heard LSD, DMT, mushrooms, right?
Mind open.
Now, told you this was going to be an interactive experience today. You want to feel a little bit more free in about 10 seconds? I want you all to reach under your seats. You get a tab, you get a tab, you get a tab. Alright, no, that party's later tonight. Sorry. If you would all bear with me for a second, if you would just ignore the barking dogs. Close your eyes, take a deep breath in, and consider for just a moment that everything is right in the universe, and slowly exhale and open your eyes. Now, if you don't understand what we did there, you will in about 20 minutes. Now, when I was in Fallujah in 2004, I was the guy who always woke up early to get the guys in my team in a good mood. I would be singing songs and telling jokes and stories, and I really believed in what we were doing there. I really believed in the mission. I was in civil affairs, you know, we were gonna shake hands and kiss babies and pass out money and, you know, help. We were gonna lead the charge rebuilding Iraq, and I really believed in what we were doing in that sense. And when I was in jail a few years later in solitary in Washington, D.C., I found myself in the same state of Zen engagement. You've seen people like this in every field of human endeavors, doing something that engages all of their energy and their passion in a righteous way that makes them more alive than doing anything else, right? And I found that while I was in jail, I had that same feeling. And I mean, I certainly enjoyed my government-induced, taxpayer-funded spiritual retreat in this amazing gated community with beautifully manicured facilities and a really, really attentive 24-hour staff, great security. And every chance I got, and when you're the guy who can record podcasts over the jail phone, the guys with name tags tend to at least follow the rules around you, you know? And so every chance I got, whether they're coming through for random checks in the middle of the night to flick the lights on and off to bug people, or delivering food or mail, or taking us on our little escorted trip to go take a shower, which is really fun, by the way, in solitary. You guys, this is always fun to ask, how many people here have been to jail? Overnights count? Anybody? No? All right. Decent show of hands here. Maybe Michigan really is that much nicer. So to take a shower, I had to get all my shower gear, have it in my hands, and pass it out to be inspected. Then I had to take off my jumpsuit and stand there naked in my flip-flops and pass that out while it got shaken out by the guard. You know, lift up the sack, squat and cough, turn around, all of that. Then they give me the clothes back, put them back on. You stick your hands behind you through the slot in the door, and they handcuff you. And then you have to go like this and pick up your shower gear and come back. And I always felt like such a badass with these big mechanical doors. I would stand there, like, and I'd make eye contact with the guard through the window slit, and they would yell, "Open 23!" And it would start going, and I was like maintaining eye contact straight ahead, like thousand yard stare, like. And then I step out and I go like this, and I give him one ankle at a time, and I get my leg shackles on, and I shuffle 20 feet down the hall, and then we repeat the process in reverse. And I get 20 minutes to shower. No, it was 10 minutes then. 10 minutes to shower and then back to the cell. Same whole process all over again. So anyway, every chance I got, I would tell the guards, "Can I talk to you for a minute?" And those of you who have been in jail understand what it means to be a ward of the state. If you say, "Hey, I have an issue, I need to talk to you," they have some responsibility there, right? So, "Hey, I need to tell you something. Can you come here?" And they would come up to the window slit in the door, and I would say, "You're a free, beautiful, independent human being, and you should never let anyone tell you otherwise. Have a nice day." And it's the people who've been to jail who are laughing at that, because they know exactly what the guard's thinking, right? "How the hell is that guy on the inside of the cage happier than I am on the outside?" Well, maybe because you dress up in a silly costume every day, you work a terrible 9-to-5 as a cog in the machine, and your boss doesn't give a damn about you. Whereas the people that I'm working for have a lot more love to give. And what I realized during this time, and referring to it as a spiritual retreat is really not that inaccurate, but there's something fundamental to the human existence that we don't remind ourselves of enough. That is, that you have the ability to choose your demeanor at all times. Your outlook, your mood, your attitude is always your choice. Every bad day is self-imposed. Real freedom is here. If you don't know how to be happy, what's the point of being free? Now, some people get this from meditation, from living well, from acid occasionally, believe it or not. But we talk about very openly all the negative effects of government propaganda, right? How government wants you to be afraid, they want you to be angry, divided, to be beaten down in a way to see government as this authoritative parental figure. But we don't talk enough about the flip side of that. What would it mean to be impervious to that? How could you inoculate yourself and others from that kind of manipulation? Now, in the course of waking up, we are all brought down at some level, right?
Yeah.
Nobody goes, "Gee, the world's more fucked up than I ever imagined possible. Yay!" Right? How many of you, in the course of paying attention, felt some kind of anger at government? All right. Sometimes we get a round of applause for that when we have like really angry people. Yeah, let's hear it for the angry people. But if you have any sense of justice, right, it has to get you riled up a little bit. How about when you notice that you're more likely to be killed by a cop than a terrorist by a factor of about 50 times? Or that, while your neighbor might steal from you, the IRS is a guarantee that you will be stolen from. How many of you felt some kind of fear in the course of waking up and went, maybe for the first time, you're afraid of the right things? Right, all right. Very honest audience, or very cooperative. I say, raise your hands, everybody raises your hands. Normally people are too afraid to raise their hands to answer that question.
Too obstinate.
But, yeah, right. And then you look back at some point on the scope of the cost of statism, right? Of war, of the wealth transfer, of the lives destroyed and opportunity squandered. And you have to be sad or depressed at some level, right? Anybody? Anybody felt sad or depressed in the course of waking up and paying attention? Great. Honesty. That's what's great. I'm not being depressed. Just to be clear. I am anti-depression. Speaking of which, does anybody here hate themselves enough to have watched the Republican presidential debate? Just a little bit? You don't want to admit it here in this crowd, do you? Right? I don't even remember which candidate it was. Like, I'm for telling the truth and doing what I say and telling the truth and doing the right thing, and I'm always going to tell the truth. And everybody's like, telling the truth? Whoa, that's a really good idea. We should try electing someone who's going to do that. Yeah. I mean, gosh. Okay, we can stop making fun of the Republican primary voters' gullibility at this point. But what do we do then with this awareness, right? This negative response that we get. We take that as a pretty good motivation. And then we grab our signs and our bullhorns and we go out on the street corner and we yell, "Now join me in my fear and my anger and my depression!" Some of you are laughing and some of you are going, "Shit. I think I've been that guy."
Oh, yeah.
And what's the response that you get?
Fuck off.
Fuck you! I'm going back to watching Dancing with the Stars. I'm going to be a happy little wage slave. Why would I want your truth if it brings you down? It's going to make my life better? Are you kidding? And we've been suckered, really, into thinking of this as a political movement, right? If politics is the conversation of who do you point the guns of government at to organize society, and our premise is no, this isn't a political movement, this is an anti-political movement. You're sick of politics? Good, we got the cure for that too. This is a philosophy movement, an ethics movement, a morals movement, a cultural movement, a self-actualization movement, a human development movement. And then what do we do though? We get a little self-conscious, like, oh, I'm gonna put on a suit and tie and comb my hair and go out and tell everybody I'm a good little wage slave and I pay my taxes too. And they go, I don't know about that. I think the people who are ready to hear this message want to hear it from people like you who are living differently as a result of this and want to know how it improves their lives right now. You want to be like Sisyphus rolling that rock up the hill over and over again? Keep winning debates. Keep winning arguments, votes, signatures, Facebook flame wars. You all know the guy who was converted to libertarianism by losing a Facebook flame war? Yeah, me neither. So how do people wake up? How do people come to this, right? Well, if you go to people with the zero-sum game of politics, I'm right, you're wrong, let's argue, guess what? You're gonna lose every time. Who's the first one to win every argument? The first person to stop arguing. So, if you go to people instead with, hey, I've got this philosophy, I've got this perspective that, by the way, could solve most of the world's problems, but more importantly for you right now, hey, it's made me happier, it's allowed me to live more free, would you like to hear about this? You don't usually get the reaction like, well, I don't know, be free and happy? Jeez, who's gonna build the roads? You see how you get to bypass all of that with this approach? And by the way, I mean, I could give you the answer to that question. I could recite Walter Block's 500-page book about who's going to build the roads and tell you about insurance companies and auto manufacturers and developers and gas companies and so on. But what's the most important answer that we can give in terms of how are things going to be in a nonviolent society? I don't know. I don't pretend. I'm not a central planner. That's the point. I don't pretend to have the collective wisdom of millions of people interacting peacefully, coming together to find out how their interests are best served. So if you get those kinds of questions when you're talking to someone, and they say, well, okay, I like your ideas, but how are we going to defend ourselves from the blah, blah, blah? You say, I don't know. Let's figure it out. Can you help me figure it out? You're pretty smart. And all of a sudden, guess what? The game has changed 180 degrees. Instead of them fighting you and the burden being on you, they are helping you figure out how we create a more voluntary society. How about that? Neat little Jedi mind trick, isn't it? Being free and happy instead of arguing with people. We can call that a Jedi mind trick now. Do you see how this changes your attitude to your activism entirely? When you want to share something that's beautiful? You can, when you have this kind of internal freedom, because a lot of people think that the freedom, we've been tricked, even in the language that we use to talk about this, right? From Jefferson, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Well, if you can't have life, you can't have liberty. If you don't have liberty, you can't pursue happiness. Fight for liberty, and then someday, eventually down the road, you can be happy. Bullshit. Happiness is not something that you can chase down, beat over the head with a club, and drag home to your cave to enjoy forever and ever. It is a choice that you make right now in the moment. And when you get that kind of emotional freedom, you can put a smile on your face, literally with a boot heel on your neck. And when you do, you look up at that guy, and there's no hatred, there's no anger, there's no animosity anymore. Maybe pity, empathy, but you don't really think that the cops and beat up protesters are well-adjusted human beings who go home to happy, loving households every night, do you? Or the politicians who seek satisfaction through power, do you think that that ever makes them happy to win the next election? That really gives them any kind of inner peace or satisfaction? Or the bankers, we all know how central that racket is, right? I think it was George Carlin who said, trying to make yourself happy with money is like trying to satisfy your hunger by duct taping sandwiches to your body. It doesn't work. And when you can share this instead, we can reach the people who need this message more than anybody else. And if I may take a quick commercial break here for the book Freedom, I started writing this while I was in jail, and I was able to do a survey of the literature of our movement, at least somewhat in my head, somewhat from all the wonderful books that people sent to me. Going back to Socrates, to Plato, to Smith, to Locke, to Smith, to Bastiat, to Spooner, someone's going to get me on the chronology here, to Mises, to Hayek, to Rand, to Rothbard, to Konkin, to Paul Sr., to Woods, to Molyneux, right? And all the ways that people had tried to convey this message. And I looked at all the different ways that people actually wake up. And it doesn't happen through conversation. It can start that way. It can be encouraged by that. But what does it really take for someone to embrace what for them is a radically divergent worldview, or what seems as such, at least? It takes quiet contemplation. It takes an acceptance here. It takes a certain amount of meditation, a certain amount of I'm going to factor all of the data in that I've got in my head, and it has to make sense in this new equation. And what I found is that for a lot of people, what's the difference between a statist and a libertarian?
6 months.
About 6 months? Not anymore. It's more like a week of watching YouTube videos and reading Wikipedia articles, right?
Or talking to
now, all of the people who are naturally engaged, well, how many people saw the Thomas Jefferson dance party video from 2011? All right. It's always fun to get people to come up to me, even years later, and be like, that woke me up! And I'm like, you're lying! Because nobody was like, oh my God, did you see that guy get chokeslammed by the cops? Yeah, and the Fed, right? There's a bit of a leap there. But for those of us who had to resolve that cognitive dissonance, or felt ourselves as victims of the state and wanted to understand why, we're already here. And I just want to take a step back. We talked about marijuana earlier, marijuana usage, and here in particular, right? It's really exciting to just appreciate where we are historically right now. This is the end of the beginning of the end of the war on drugs. What a beautiful thing to step back and appreciate, right? To see that it's like a chunk of a glacier. When it starts to break off, and you see the crack form, you hear the creak, and then it just starts to fall, and you're like, yeah, it's just a matter of time, right? And I think along with that, we see that there is really a psychedelic renaissance happening in the United States as people understand some of the implications of that, and it's very exciting to see. So, in sharing this message, I've got a challenge for everybody, and it's to read the book. That's not the challenge, I know. It's only 100 pages. It's in short, 1 to 2 page sections. It's a free audiobook, and I know you got to twist people's arms to get them to read a book these days, but it's 2015. You can listen to an audiobook and tell people that you read it. It's okay. There's not going to be a test at the end of this. So it's all in line with all of these principles that I've been talking about. It's in line with the principles of nonviolent communication. It's no opinion, no conjecture, no wishful thinking, no unnecessary labels, no derogatory language. It's not Amerocentric. It's global in its scope. It's universal to the human condition. And I wrote it to be the fastest way to take someone from zero to I get it. We have a section on soldiering. This is a book that I wish people had given me in high school when I said, hey, I'm a libertarian, right? And by the way, my introduction to the message was in high school. Then it was a very bad, watered-down, politicized version of it. But in high school, they said, hey, you're going to have to vote soon. Do you want to be a Republican or Democrat? Really? I don't have a choice? I have to be totally fucking lame? Are you kidding? Tell me there's some other option. Can I opt out? And I was like, really? Come on. You got to give me something else here. And so I remember my teacher explaining this, and it was like going to a used car dealership when they take you to the back corner of the lot to the cars that they don't even want people to be able to see from the street. And they're like, well, back here we've got this thing. You might be able to get it home. We don't really know what happened in the back seat, but it's called the Libertarian Party, and they like to be left alone. And I was like, yeah! I mean, I'm a punk kid, right? Leave me alone. And it took me 10 years. I was really slow. It took me 10 years to go from that to understanding what it really meant. And there's a section on the book on soldiering. And one of the reasons I'm so passionate about people getting the message of freedom, not at a political level, but at a philosophical level, is because I got it at a political level, and it didn't stop me from enlisting in the Marine Corps. It didn't stop me from volunteering to go to Iraq. It didn't stop me from torturing people. And no one who has read Chapter 3, Section 3, has ever enlisted in the United States military. So we got a perfect record on that so far. We also received the most important endorsement we could have possibly gotten for this book recently from the United States Department of Justice. And a letter from them, from their Bureau of Prisons, saying that the book is banned in jails. They called the entire publication a threat to the good order, security, and discipline of the institution. And if they mean government itself, I couldn't take that as a more ringing endorsement. So, and you guys might think, well, hey, it's not a big deal, right? It's just jails. Do you know how many Americans are in jails?
Yes.
And do you know that that's the only place that Americans still consistently read books? Yeah. And every time we've got the book into a jail, actually, it's been passed around very enthusiastically. So we've been giving away the book everywhere we go on the tour. So we encourage people, if you can take one, please take one. If you want to take two or three to share. But I have a challenge here. I think we're going to get a pretty good answer to this question. How many of you can honestly say that everybody in your immediate family who you're in regular contact with understands why you care about freedom? Not bad, not bad. Typical response, though, from what we've seen on the tour here. And there's really no reason that we shouldn't all have our hands up for that. And I'll tell you why, if nothing else, because I have this tool here. And by the way, the challenge that I've been issuing people on the tour is not just read the book, but decide for yourself then if it's the most effective way for you to share the message with someone new. And if it's not, find what is for yourself and do that. Because I guarantee that that is the activism that you will find the most satisfying. Now, because we have this, and it's just one tool of many, you can go to anyone and say, hey, especially a family member, hey, I love you, you love me, I care about you, we've gotten to know each other pretty well since you gave birth to me or whatever, and I'd like you to take maybe 15 minutes over the next month to just understand something that I'm passionate about. Would you do that for me? Like, I've got this book, I grabbed you a copy. The first 9 pages sum up. Would you read 9 pages? They're pretty short, it's really easy. Or hey, free audiobook, you want, we can listen to it on the way to school. I'll be happy to sit there and listen to it with you. Or hey, while you're working, I'll read it to you. But you know what, it would really mean a lot if I could just take 15 minutes to share something that I care about with you. Would you be willing to listen to that and really consider that?
Who could say no?
Well, if they do, you should probably reconsider those relationships, right? But who could say no to that when you go with that positive attitude and you say, no, this is, I'm not trying to convince you of anything. I'm not trying to tell you that you're wrong. I just want to share something that I'm passionate about with you. And the book is just one tool for that, obviously. There are lots of other ways. But one of the things that we don't ask ourselves enough is where this is going. And it's always fun to ask people, are there any South Park fans here? Yeah, all right. Another trend within the movement, a little minor cultural thing perhaps, right? We're gonna go back to season 6, I think. Episode, Underpants Gnomes. All right, good. Step 1, underpants. Step 2, step 3, profit. Sound familiar? You see where we're going with this? Step 1, paradigm shift. Step 2, social collapse. Step 3, free society. That's not an answer. And if we're really here because we love people, because we want a better world for people, we want a freer society, then having your guns and your gold and your ammo and hoping that the government is going to spare you in its violent death throes as it desperately clings to power is not an answer. Because if we end up in that situation and the government is protecting people huddling in the cities, guess what? They're going to come after you first. They're going to make an example out of you. But it doesn't matter. If you have your 40 acres and your homestead, and you built your home yourself, and you're completely upgraded and self-sustainable, if you stare at the computer screen all day being angry at the world, you're not free. They win, you lose. You have to get it here first before you can share it with someone else in a positive way. And the other question that we get to ask, it's really fun. About the transition. The answer is localization. And it's really simple because we know that it's going to happen one way or another, right? When you realize that centralized systems of control are not sustainable, it's just a matter of how and how peaceful and how orderly can we make it. So you look at the war on drugs as an example, you know, I mean, this huge chunk of the racket falling away. And the war on drugs, like, it really is huge, and this really is a big thing to appreciate historically, this significant turning point. I mean, we've got the monetary system, right, is like the heart of the racket, like the biggest single part of the ripoff. You've got the war military-industrial complex, right? You've got welfare and education, and right up there, war on drugs, pharmaceuticals, prison-industrial complex, law enforcement, the judicial system, all of that. And what do we see? We see local governments taking charge, saying we're going to have a different set of laws here, and you see the federal government violently resisting. Right, you still see, this is the worst violence that we see in this, is that you have, you know, federal agents raiding dispensaries in California and Colorado and other places, and still, you know, screwing with dealers and importers. I don't know what other terms we want to use for that. In so many other ways. So the question really is not, is localization going to happen, but how peaceful, how deliberate, how orderly can we make it? The state is not going to end one day sooner because you read another book about monetary theory. The state is going to end sooner because you learned how to talk to people you care about what was important to you. So, how many of you can say that, well, first I got to, we have fans of Konkin here, right? Sam Konkin, that's awesome. That's more hands than we've had anywhere on tour. Sam Konkin, godfather of agorism. More importantly, he had a joke he liked to tell. So there were two definitions of libertarian. One, anybody who calls themselves a libertarian. Some of you see a problem with this, I can tell. Because then you have Bill Maher and Glenn Beck. I'm sorry, Glenn Beck and Bill Maher calling themselves libertarian. Any fans of Bill Maher here? New rule, Bill. I mean, if you believe that libertarian simply means believing in freedom, sorry, you can't donate $1 million to the Obama campaign and tell me it's because you believe in freedom. But his second definition,
Anyone who agrees with me on absolutely everything. Some of you have been that guy too, right? It's okay, we can't be right about everything all the time. That's my job, you're welcome. But you guys see a problem with that as well, right? So I'd like to suggest a different definition that I think more accurately speaks to the core of this movement. Because I like to talk about the broader freedom movement of humanity, but obviously there's a core of us who are conscientiously and deliberately moving humanity forward on this count. So I would say people who can articulate freedom as a principle and at least attempt to apply it consistently. How many of us in America, 320 something million Americans, how many of us would you say there are right now?
A couple hundred thousand?
A couple million? Anybody else? Okay, because you could go really broad with this, right, and say, well, if you're socially liberal and fiscally conservative and you get up to like 15-20% of people who will still make terribly status decisions in their lives versus what we see as really this core of people who get it at a deeper level. And the consensus that we've had on the tour is that there's about a million of us. Kind of puts things in perspective, doesn't it? If we want to grow this movement, we have to be honest about what we're doing. We have to win converts. And it's converts to a different way of thinking, right? It's not to any dogma. If anything, it's to the anti-dogma. But converting people to be able to think for themselves. And again, being suckered into thinking of this as a political movement, we end up with all of the futility and all the frustration, all that negativity. But you think about that guy who gets that everything is right in the universe. What goes along with that, whether it's through meditation or fitness, or, you know, for me, I used to run barefoot, that was my meditation. That sense that everything is right in the universe, the person who gets that also gets a certain sense of self-acceptance. And that person can no longer be manipulated by fear. That person is free. And we are in a position to give that to other people. Now, a lot of people end up afraid as a result of this. They stay stuck in that, you know, in that negativity, in that reaction. And there are a lot of people who, you know, they go out with, you know, if we don't storm the barricades with our pitchforks now, it's 1,000 years of tyranny and darkness. By the way, buy my survival seats and water filters. You ever get the feeling that people like that don't really want you to be free? They want you to be afraid. And so a lot of people try to drag you down to that level or keep you in that state of emotional reaction rather than moving forward to actually living free. So, other fun question to ask, when for people who get that definition, the bottom of the rabbit hole, so to speak, on freedom or voluntarism or anarcho-capitalism, whatever, how many of you can say that you came to this understanding in the last 5 years? Wow. What does that tell you?
Growing.
Do you guys, it's happening! Thank you. I was looking for the right words for that. Yes, it's happening! Now, we take this down to a much more conservative estimate from the bias of people who are coming to events right now. From my experience out around the country, and I hope for those of you who are connected to the movement online, that you can, it's pretty safe to say over half of us got here in the last 5 years, right? And you can actually go back, and I had the privilege recently of speaking to some older gentlemen from the John Birch Society who know the history, like going back to the 70s, the foundation of the Libertarian Party. And what we see is a really nice, healthy growth curve. Now, it's not exponential because it's an S-curve of adoption, right? Eventually, everybody's going to get this. But we're still at the point where things are rapidly accelerating. Now, if there's only a million of us, and we only double every 5 years, this isn't going to take very long. Do you think of the million of us that are out there in America, on average, we can wake up one other person in the next 5 years? Sounds like a pretty conservative estimate, doesn't it? We can maintain this growth rate at least. and critical mass in several decades at most. Now, what? I love doing libertarian fantasy math. What if only a quarter of us are active at all? What if three quarters of us are totally checked out, already got the cabin in the woods? There's a quarter million of us active. Can we wake up on average four, to pick up the slack for the rest, can we wake up an average of four people in the next 5 years? How about those of us who are really committed to this? Maybe the top 10% of people who get this. Maybe just the 100,000 of us who are really active, who are the core of this movement. Can we wake up 10 people in the next 5 years? I mean, you do one every 6 months? If you commit yourself to that, like, I am going to win a convert. I'm going to share this message. And I might move on if I find someone who really needs therapy before they're ready to hear that. And there are some people out there with authoritarian personality disorder who are going to need a little other help before they're ready to hear this. But there are people out there. Can you find one every 6 months? Can you make that commitment? How about for the real super activists that we have out here? Can you just say you're going to wake up one other person per month? Just one person. Now, like any good politician, I see a riot, I jump in front of it, and I call it a parade, right? I'm just here trying to take credit for what we see as a shift in the movement already. People are sick of winning debates. They're sick of winning arguments. And they've realized that the best feedback that you ever get as an activist is, thank you, you woke me up. Thank you, you changed my perspective. Thank you, you kept me from enlisting. Thank you, you helped me make a career decision. Thank you, you kept me from ending up under a mountain of student debt and finding a better career. Thank you, you've made me freer and happier. People want that now. They don't want to win arguments and debates anymore. So I'd like to think that we've provided one other tool for this. And I'm happy to take questions for as long as people want here. But I do want to close at least my part of this by saying something about who we are as a movement right now, this 0.33%. And we have a really unique opportunity historically to appreciate that right now and see where things are going and realize that all of these curves of the human experience, of technology, of life expectancy, of productivity, of awareness, of information, of technology, are increasing exponentially. We are at the asymptote of the human experience, of things turning upwards at a point where our puny brains can't even perceive just how fast society and technology are going to be progressing. How many of you guys have heard of longevity escape velocity? All right, it's a very intellectual crowd here. For those of you that haven't heard of this, I'm very excited to share this with you. When life expectancy starts going up more than 1 year per year, guess what? No one dies of old age unless you choose to. And if you're young and healthy today, guess what? Congratulations, you made it.
Yay.
Kind of changes things, doesn't it? You look at Moore's Law, and technology, and the communication, connectedness. And, you know, if I may go back for a minute, you know, I say this as someone who has experienced the global war on terror firsthand. And chapter 3 in the book also talks about how governments will always conduct as much war as they can get away with. In the age of technology and connectedness that we live in, they simply cannot get away with what they used to. I have a device in my pocket that used to take a building to house this computing power. It is now connected to everyone else on the planet who has one of these. We are just starting, oh, by the way, you can get the book as an app for free as well. We are just starting to realize the impact of this technology. And as someone who was involved in Iraq Veterans Against the War from pretty close to the beginning, people aren't, you know, we didn't change policy at all. You know, the anti-war movement was revealed to be an anti-Bush movement. You guys want to know how sick that really is?
Yeah.
There were millions of people in this country, millions of liberal activists, who subconsciously said to themselves, oh, you want to give me free health care? Well, in that case, yeah, go ahead, keep bombing brown people on the other side of the planet. That's cool. Pretty sad when you put it in those terms, isn't it? But despite not being able to change policy in Iraq because Obama tried to have troops there longer than Bush wanted them, what happened when he tried to get boots on the ground in Syria? It was service members with the little placards in front of their faces on social media. I did not enlist to fight for Al-Qaeda in Syria, right? And of course, what do? They got the money from the CIA and the State Department to the people they needed to get it to anyway to spend the money. But look at Iran. How long have they been trying to get a war with Iran going? And I mean in the modern era, they've got nukes, we got to invade. Not just like, you know, 1953, going back to all that. But you simply cannot, in this day and age, dress up millions of gullible young men in silly costumes and have them meet in the middle of a field and kill each other because they're wearing different colors. Inconceivable. And yes, I know what that word means. Thank you, Princess Bride fans. So, this 0.33%, who we are now, is the first people who get to really embrace this message, who really get to be a part of this movement. And I hope that nobody who's here, especially in an event like this, having as much fun as you are, is coming at this from a sense of obligation or duty or fear or responsibility still. If anything, I would hope that having the experience, I know for some people, coming together in a community like this, this being the third iterance of this festival, are experiencing this for the first time. And it's a really beautiful thing to see, to be a part of, right? Where you can say, you know, welcome to the real movement here. It's not about being angry anymore. It's not about that fear. And we get to participate in this. It becomes an opportunity, a joyous way to live, to engage in activism. And it's not selflessness, right? All we're doing is serving our higher visions for ourselves of what humanity can be. And you see the people who really get this, we never burn out as activists. We get to be a part of this. We get to be a part of this joyous dance forward for humanity. And I'm always tempted to quote the Apple commercial from the 90s, you know, think different. Here's to the crazy ones. Well, fuck that. There's nothing good about being labeled sane in a sick society, right? And I want to say, here's to the rebels and the outcasts and the misfits. You know, rebels against bullshit and injustice, but it's not the captains of the football teams or the cheerleader squads or the student body presidents who are the first ones to question this, right? The people who recognize that we are victims of the system, the people who have the integrity to face up to that, the people who have decided that we want to participate in this, we want to lead this, we want to help others, we want to improve the world. So I'm really glad I don't have to embarrass my fiance now, because someone already said that we have better relationships as libertarians, and it's true in the way that you connect with someone. And it's really amazing to be able to come to an event like this and feel this as this community and as a part of it. And I'm so honored to be lucky enough to have fallen into my role and to be able to travel the country spreading this message and helping people become better advocates and better activists. So to all of us lovers, dreamers, and visionaries, thank you so much for your time and attention today. Here's to us. Live free, be happy. Any questions? No, good. All right. Anybody? We can tell war stories, we can tell jail stories.
Are you still planning on running for president?
Well, now that you mention it. It's funny, I've been getting that question a lot. And if things keep coming together around this book, around this message, around my own reputation capital in terms of growing this movement, then yes, I intend to run for the Libertarian nomination for president in 2020 on the platform of a peaceful, orderly dissolution of the entire United States federal government.
Woo!
And thank you. As long as we get responses like that, I think we're going to keep growing. I think by 2020, it's going to be very reasonable. I think if people keep winning converts like this, if people take what I've said today to heart, it's going to be very easy. And you know what? A lot of us, in terms of reaching out, we get a little self-conscious. You know, in the politicization of the message, we've been fooled into thinking we need to water this down. Oh no! Are you liberal? Are you socially liberal and fiscally conservative? Here, have a pamphlet. You can be one of us now, right? And I go to people sharing this book on the tour. Like, you know, we've had some problems with our rig. We've dealt with a lot of mechanics and service stops and stuff. And they say, oh, what's Freedom? Oh, it's a book. I do a YouTube channel. Can I give you a copy? And they say, what's it about? Creating a more peaceful, harmonious, and productive society by abolishing government. And they go, yeah, I want that kind of freedom. And when you start with that, it's really easy to get people on board as opposed to, well, you know, we want to run around naked doing drugs with our hair on fire, and we need to get the government out of the way so we can stop paying taxes so we can afford all the good stuff.
One more thing.
You know, okay, well, we're just sales pitch-wise, you know. We got to get to the more universal appeal of this. That is, if you get to run around naked with your hair on fire doing all the drugs you want without paying taxes, then guess what? Everybody else gets to keep their distance and live in a more peaceful, harmonious, and free society, right? But even with the presidential platform telling people this, like, well, I think it'd be very reasonable over 4 years that we could dissolve the entire federal government, not really challenge people's immediate experience of statism in terms of, well, you still have a state government that's going to perform X, Y, and Z functions. But most people, when they hear that, they go, yeah, sounds like a pretty good start to me. So I really think 2020, we can, if we get the nomination in 2020, we can plant the flag on this idea. The goal would be to get 3-5%. I think that's pretty reasonable. And in 2024 or 2028, if not me, have someone else running on this platform who you know, can then be a contender and really get the ball moving on this. But what I'd like to see, I don't want to be president. I'll be running to win, I'll be ready to win. We'll have a platform that's specific enough that though that it doesn't matter if I win or if someone else wins on that platform, or if I get taken out, hey, shove in the next douchebag in a suit, and the platform is there, the paradigm shift has happened, people demand this. And if you don't have that, it's not going to happen anyway. You're going to have a worse backlash. So, yeah, so things keep building. We're very much looking forward to that.
When you go to run for that platform, something that I've been thinking about for a long time is there are hundreds of thousands of people who are very incentivized to fight tooth and nail against the abolition of the government because they rely on it for their daily bread. What kind of argument or reasoning or negotiating position do you have in mind for relating to these people who are going to see you as the guy who's trying to take the bread off of their table?
Thank you for asking that the easy way. The hard way would have been, why do you hate poor people, Adam? Right? And the answer is actually very simple. We don't want to pull the rug out from underneath anybody. We don't want anybody who's dependent on government to all of a sudden be at a loss. That, I mean, just from a compassionate perspective, you know, we can say that, hey, theft is wrong. Well, guess what? So is starving in the streets. And so is creating a system and then making people dependent on it and then abolishing it all of a sudden. Having a revolution would be very irresponsible. We're obviously going for an evolutionary process. And when it comes to the very essential human community function of taking care of people who need help, how do you think we're going to achieve that better? With a distant, centralized authority called the federal government, or with the local community empowered with all the resources the federal government has stolen from it, being able to do that? So the process of localization, specifically to answer your question in regards to the presidential platform, how do we advocate for this? We want states to fully take on the functions of welfare that the federal government has taken on and immediately do a better, more efficient, if you might argue still immoral by being funded, you know, funded by tax, do a that much better job of it. And if you care about freedom and you don't want to be taxed as much, you don't want people to be stolen from as much, you got to say, hey, I'd rather have an efficient welfare system than an inefficient one that leads to all of this extraneous theft, right? In a way, I think we have a harder time selling this to the hardcore, you know, ANCAPers than we do the mainstream. We'll go, gee, yeah. When our community has the resources that it's producing, as opposed to having them stolen and shuffled through the bureaucracy and then a small part of them returned to us, yeah, we're going to do a better job of being able to take care of people who need it in our communities. Not only that, we're going to be able to create whole other systems that you couldn't even possibly envision under today's system, because you're not allowed to create them. You don't have the resources to create them. We are going to see so many better ways of people being able to come together and more effectively take care of people who need that help. And if anything, you're going to see a lot of the problems of the current welfare system solved, because you're not going to have the massive bureaucracy, you're not going to have the massive dependency, and you're not going to have the massive ripoff that it represents. So I think we're okay selling that one.
Might I suggest that you endorse mutual aid societies as a possible replacement for...
Absolutely, mutual aid societies. Well, I think that in a sense, and one of the things I'm looking forward to about this is writing the book American Freedom, which is going to be the campaign platform in 100 pages, same format, irrefutable language, very easy to digest. And I don't know all the answers. I don't pretend to say, yeah, this is how we're going to dissolve the federal government in 4 years. I need to do a lot of research. I need to bring together a lot of experts on that. And, you know, there's some departments that are really easy, like Department of Education. What do you do? Hey, 2 months notice, 2 months severance pay, get out of here, sell the buildings, except for the big one in D.C., we're going to turn that into a museum, you know? Now, there are a couple other ones that are just as easy that might be a little bit more fun, like the IRS. We're going to get everybody into a room, and we're going to draw a dotted line around their wrists and then say, you're welcome for not doing that. And then send them all home. You know, you cut the hands off thieves. Okay, sorry, I was a little obtuse there. Department of Defense. There you have a little more complicated knot to untangle. There are some things that are obvious, easy right away. All the troops come home from abroad. All the embassies are closed. Great, piece of cake, right? All the foreign bases. You know, even that, you can say, the concept's very easy. There's no repercussions of selling a foreign base. Like, it's not like, oh, if we don't have Launchpad Germany with all of its airplanes, you know, with the United States Army, then terrorists are going to attack Cleveland, you know? Nobody's going to, you know, be afraid of that. So there's a lot of things that you can do easily, but then there's some things that are going to take most of 4 years to really untangle and localize. And I don't know exactly how much we're going to be able to sell this to people, because this is what it's about. It's about selling this message and getting people to embrace a different worldview and a different platform specifically. But I don't know if people are going to be inspired in the mainstream now. This is part of the cool test that this represents. By the end goal. You know, you dissolve the federal government, then you dissolve state governments, and then at the county or city or local community level, you can create private property-based voluntary systems to displace them, right? How local do we want to go? Down to the divine individual. But how much do we want to sell this on? And then you get to run around naked with your hair on fire doing all the drugs you want for free without paying taxes. You get that too. I don't know if that's going to really be a good selling point for the mainstream, but mutual aid societies, you're right, that we can show people, and I think there's going to be a point at which we decide how much is that part of the message. So I hope that in 4 more years, if, you know, hey, we could double every year at this point, I really would not be surprised if the growth rate actually went to that. If in 2020, instead of there being about 1 million of us, there were 5 million? You know, I think that you're going to see already the culture shifted. But there's one big thing in this that we like, a huge variable. Where are we with the monetary system in 2020? And that's really going to drive a whole lot of other factors going into this. So, next question.
Thanks, Adam. How did you discover nonviolent communication, and how important do you think it'll be in the transition to a free and voluntary society?
That's a great question. Now, a lot of libertarians have their, you know, the mentioned fantasy math. Well, it's like, if everybody just stopped paying taxes tomorrow, the state would be gone in a week, right? You know, stuff like that. But I will make the one exception for nonviolent communication. If people really, if everybody got that, the state would end in a generation or two. With no other political awareness, no libertarian movement, if everybody got nonviolent communication, absolutely. I got turned on to it by a friend. I was led to watch a 3-hour Marshall Rosenberg presentation with the puppets, you know? And I had to get the warning. The dude who told me this was like, all right, and this guy covered in tattoos. He's like, all right, dude, Marshall's gonna bust out these puppets, okay? It's cool-o. You'll get it, like, just go with it. Just go with it. And it's like, you know, the jackal and the giraffe puppets, so. And then I read the book. And then when I started dating Macy, I voluntarily made her sit down and watch that 3-hour seminar with me. And she loved it. She was really into it. So we bought the book, and she's read it now, and I read it for the second time, so. I was just a tip from a friend who told me that it made his relationships better, that he wanted other people to get this. So, I mean, it doesn't take much. If I may, you know, sell this a little bit more, there's really only one other book I recommend on par with Freedom, and that's Nonviolent Communication by Marshall Rosenberg. And it really will change your life. It will change every relationship in your life for the better, including your relationship with the state. So, does that answer your question? All right. Yes, sir.
As far as the incremental reduction of the state that you were talking about, you know, get rid of the IRS and a couple other things, what if that backfires and it makes the state palatable to people? As an example, the guys that say, well, if 10% is good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for Uncle Sam. They don't mind paying 10%, and 10% is their goal. So how do you get past that and not make the state palatable? And then also give people the false impression that the state can be made good.
Well, I think there's a little bit of a misunderstanding here. It's a great question. I want to address it fully. But it's not, we're going to take away pieces of the federal government or, you know, elements of government. It's we're going to take away a layer of government, the federal layer entirely. I just have fun talking about getting rid of the IRS, that's all. So, your question, though, about the people who are of a minarchist mentality or a limited government mentality, fine. All we have to get them on board with first is the one step of localization of getting rid of the federal government and returning that authority to the states. I don't even, in order to do that, I don't even have to challenge your view of statism at all. You want a massive welfare state, you want a hyper-liberal environment, you want that regulation, cool, go live in New York, you know? And in this process, I mean, I wonder about like Manhattan in particular, and we gotta have an answer for this. Like, in the process of localization, transitioning to a free society, what the heck do you do with the island of Manhattan? You know, if it wasn't for the Federal Reserve System and this fountain of money in the middle, like, there'd be no incentive for people to live that close to each other. And a lot of them want to, but can you really say that someone on that island owns their property, even in any kind of functional system that maintains people living that closely together? No, I think in the case of Manhattan, it becomes a private property collective. You have the corporation of Manhattan, and we just stop lying to each other and saying that you own this property. No, you're a renter, and you're a member of this corporation by virtue of holding some shares in it. You want to live in a minarchist environment? Fine, have that. You have that in your state. Eventually we'll say, well, guess what? Now you can have that in your county. Well, now you can have that in your city, and my land in unincorporated county area is now truly free territory. So it really, the process of localization, one of the amazing properties of this is that it really has an appeal for everybody. You don't have to convince anybody of a completely different worldview. You still think you need to be governed? Great. Wouldn't you rather be governed at a more local level than at a you know, centralized federal level? And I think all of those people that you're talking about were really stuck there. And the reason that's such a good question is that a lot of people, when they wake up, they go like halfway down the rabbit hole, right? They go to the Constitution, and I was there for like a couple of years, you know. Dark days. Yeah, the Constitution. If we just preferred the Constitution, everything would be peachy keen and the world would be perfect, right? And you know, wait a second. No, I don't think it really works that way. But if we get those people on board just with the localization, I think that's enough. More importantly, in the long term, we're not going to have to worry about this because everybody's going to get this. And some people say, yeah, we have to wait for people to die, right, before we're able to make this transition, like the John McCains of the world, and he might not make it to longevity escape velocity. Unless you judgment from the cheap seats is plenty, as we'll leave it at that. But no, everybody's capable of getting this. It's just a matter of time. And like I said, for me, I was really slow. It took me 10 years. And the longer you've been around, the more layers of statism that you've got built up, you know, maybe the harder it is to embrace it. But I really think that everybody is capable of getting this message and will eventually. You know, like the first people who came up with oral hygiene, Like, they didn't have to argue with people. All they had to do was smile. Like, hey, you want to keep your teeth? Like, we don't have to argue with people. This is just the next evolution of human understanding of social organization. You know, it says, how soon can we get everybody on board? So that what I've done, I think, is create two different ways for people to get on board. One, the philosophy, and two, the practice of localization. And it's going to take a long time before we even get to a critical mass, of people shifting to think outside the box. Although, with the younger people coming up, I mean, I just turned 29 for the fifth time, so I can call myself a millennial. When you're on the cusp of generations, you always identify with the younger one, right? But people who grew up with the internet, like, they don't have any emotional attachment to, well, the United States is going to be this shape, because that's what it is on a map, and that's what we've always grown up with. There's no emotional, psychological attachment to that. And so thinking outside of the box, oh yeah, localization. We don't even have to fight an emotional reaction. There's like, it's about time we considered something like that. So, anybody else? All right, well, I have one last administrative note then. You can't buy any books today because they're free, because people contributed to our Indiegogo campaign to make this tour possible last year. So please take one. We have tons of stickers. Take a couple stickers if you like. If there are any cop cars in your town, you know, stickers are good for them. We also have our trailer here, the Freedom Mobile that we've been living out of for the last year. In the back, you're all welcome to come and sign the ceiling in our trailer. It's been a lot of fun making that like a yearbook of the tour. And for those of you that want to contribute to help keep us on the road, it's really been amazing that we've been able to maintain the pace that we've had and schedule so many events and come to this at the last minute. I really want to thank everybody who invited us out and made this possible. If you want to donate to help keep us going, we really appreciate it. So, thank you very much. Oh, and you can come meet Baloo, our puppy, who is also a survivor of police brutality.
And on behalf of the Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition, I just want to send a big warm thanks to Adam for coming up here and being awesome. Thank you.